Well, hello there, Comp 1 Online students. Section 14, I'm again before you, your red-nosed English major. It's January 10th, it's Tuesday, only the second day of the week, and I haven't heard from very many of you yet on the vote over the idea of a discussion forum, but we'll get that figured out. I told you two or three videos per week, but I wanted two right away just to dig into some content and put some ideas before you, and to repeat a thing that I said the other day in my other badly made video. Remember, my other comp one up at Staples doesn't start until next week, so we're not treading water, and I'm not giving you the week off. I just am gonna do what I can to make this useful for you, get you going, thinking, reading, writing, and I want to get you lined up with them next week. So you'll do a couple of things this week that they won't. And but I hope that you still find useful. So today, on this very gray, monochromatic Tuesday afternoon, because the poem I'm gonna read to you is only two lines, let's begin with a little bit of beauty in two different forms. I'd like to listen to just a moment of music with you, and I'll try to make it only go 1 or 2 minutes, and then for a particular reason, I'd like to read you a poem from Charles Simic. So let's just, I'm sure we got a few things in common. Most of us gotta be music lovers. Take this for a ride. Forgive me, I'm old. I like classical and jazz music. That is a contemporary classical composer named Ludovico Einaudi, and that was a song from his album In a Time Lapse called Discovery at Night. And maybe what I'm doing is just kind of haphazardly wanting to have this be as much like a regular class as possible. When my students come into E339, as they did yesterday, well, yesterday didn't work because I forgot my bag, never done that before. With my computer and my entire life, money, phone, everything. Stumbling here. When they come into the room, I always like something going on, right? So when they come in, I got this groovy courtyard, I got these recess cans, E339 is where I get to have all my classes. And I want them, the minute they come in, to hear something beautiful in terms of music, and I want something on the big screen above me in that dreamy classroom that is beautiful for them to look at. A painting, it could be a photograph. Often it's pictures of my cute farm down here. And it's a way, it's a way to invite students to forget what's going on in their busy lives, right? And just sort of transition into that space that we inhabit and enjoy living in each other's company, vivid companionship. So three things today, three is the magic number. I've got news from poetry. I want to talk about the idea of keeping an academic journal, which is a big deal to me. I've already mentioned it. And I want to get you started today thinking about kind of some big picture stuff in higher education. Like I said in my classroom yesterday, things are breaking down in higher ed. We're kind of in trouble. We lost almost 700,000 students in 1 year during the pandemic. And we've also got something going on that has been going on for a while, but it's much more with much more profundity these days. We have a culture war going. And I've not done an awful lot previously to make students think about that, but I read a book about it by a friend of mine over break and started up a little two-man book club with Ryan Deblock, who's one of my beloved colleagues. And hang on a second, I'm going to keep talking because you can hear me. So three things today. I got a lavalier mic, so when I was teaching a live staples class today, I actually went all the way to my fridge to get juice, and I talked to them the whole time. I continued my lecturing and storytelling. So let's start with news from poetry. I got some sad news yesterday in a couple different ways. A Verse Like Water poet died yesterday at the age of 84, taken by dementia. The great Charles Simic, one of the greatest poets from the 20th century. I brought him in 2014. That was my biggest year hosting because, whoops, that's embarrassing. I got a, hey, it's Peyton Magney. Looks, I'm not going to reveal her vote. That would breach confidentiality, but it's one of you. One of you just texted me while I was making this video. And if I mispronounced your name, Peyton, forgive me. Anyway, Charles Simic died yesterday. I hosted him when he was about 78 years old. And somebody pinched me. I cannot believe I got to meet that guy. I also got news yesterday that the Hmong poet that I was going to host for my Verse Like Water reading series, February 24th, Mai Dervang, a rising star in American literature, is not going to be able to come this spring. Her doctor has put her on bed rest, more or less, and I'm fine with that because she's bringing a little baby into the world. And that's way more important than a poetry reading. So I'm working on getting the great Carolyn Forche with funding from Five Wings Arts Council. And I'm waiting for the phone call from New York or the text or the email, however I get it. And I'm working on that. She's kind of a friend of mine, an emerging friend of mine. And what I'd like to do is just read a super short poem in honor of Charles Simic, who was here. He was at my house. We took walks in my woods. And he read at the college, and it was one of the, it was unbelievable. This is from his book, The Voice at 3 a.m. It's kind of the title track. Charles Simic, The Voice at 3 a.m. Who put canned laughter into my crucifixion scene? That's just so amazing. It's so fun to have bookmarks from other readings. This is a Billy Collins bookmark. I've hosted him three times. You might have heard of him. He's the most famous poet on earth. Okay, here's the thing. Yesterday in my classroom, it didn't happen yesterday because it didn't come yet, but tomorrow, one of the first things I'm going to do when I get to the college is I'm going to go to the mailroom, and I know that about 140 pens are waiting for me because I always distribute free pens in the first week, usually on the first day. So it's a ritual, right? I'm going to play some very solemn and ceremonial music, and the students are going to line up and face each other in two lines, big, beautiful room. And maybe with that Ludovico Einaudi music going, I'm going to walk and distribute to each student a Faber-Castell Uniball Micropoint Deluxe, 5mm. There's only one color that's appropriate for ink and a pen, and that's black. If you want to use a ballpoint, if you want to use blue or green or whatever, that's up to you. But the most professional pen that I'm aware of since the 80s, this is my signature pen. And what's great about it is it's a metal point, right? It's like etching. I've always thought of it as a kind of a surgeon's scalpel, even though I don't correct student writing anymore exactly in the way that I used to when I was young. Doesn't mean I don't read it. And the reason for giving them these pens is because I believe in handwritten prose. I need to talk about that for a little while. I know we type. I had to write a letter, got to write a letter of recommendation for a sweet guy up in Staples named Rafael Cadillo. I wrote that last week to help him get into McAllister. Found him about 700 words, and I hope it gets him in. Did I write it out longhand beforehand? No, I typed it because that's efficacy demanded that I do it that way. When I bang out an email, I'm doing it with my keyboard, etc. But I do enjoy and believe in handwritten prose. There is something, we know this from neurological studies, from putting people in MRI scanners. We know that the entire brain picks up when a young child or a teenager or an adult picks up a pen and starts making letters. We can measure that. We can see it on scanners. Meanwhile, in other words, if you take a 10-year-old, it doesn't matter if it's a 10-year-old or a 90-year-old, if you put a 10-year-old down and tell them to trace a letter with a pen, so much is going on up there in terms of synaptic connections then if they just take hit the letter C, for instance, it's just a completely different thing. And the bulk of the prose that I have read across 36 years has been handwritten prose. I don't care what people's handwriting looks like. I don't care that much about spelling, punctuation. Students are always nervous about it at first. He's not going to like my handwriting. Wait till they see my handwriting. It looks like I had a stroke. And maybe I've had one. But I find handwriting beautiful. In the years, only two students of the 7,000 students I've served, only two students have told me that they found my handwriting beautiful. Both were from Japan. I do not know what that means. But the method for me is this. I post up a question or two each week in D2L, same with you, and then this Friday, it's going to start this Friday, I'm going to have satchels and maybe stop at Walmart, even though I hate it there, and get one of those big rolling suitcases on wheels, and I'm going to take home over 100 notebooks this weekend, maybe 90-ish, because Staples people aren't yet and you're not in there yet. I'm going to take the notebooks home. I'm going to read the responses that are tied to course material and the things we read and wondered about this week, although this is the first week, so it's going to be a lot of introduction stuff. And then I'm in the margins, right, pinging them. A little exclamation point so they think I'm chipper. If they make me happy, I might draw a smiley face. If they make me sad, I might, you know, do a frowny face. I might write out, "Sucks to be you, sorry to hear this." And then I give them a very quick, unreadable note at the end. The Academic Journal is a fantastic place. I think of it as a medieval commonplace book. It's a wonderful way to create writing each week, to get into the habitude of mind of being a writer, and bit by bit create your own knowledge about a course. Again, handwritten prose does us more good than typing prose, and it also is a fantastic place where I can get to know you. Now, my wife has started up taking a shower. I've got the door closed. Not sure if you can hear that. Probably too much information. I can hear it, and my hearing's not the greatest. So, and then next Monday, I'll spend the weekend doing it. I'll divide it across Friday, Saturday, Sunday, and then I'll haul all those notebooks up there. And students all year are going to see me getting across an icy parking lot hauling those things. I distribute them on Monday. Looks like the table is full of Chiclets, and we'll do it again. And in a hurry, they get used to it. Generally, they like it, and generally, they realize that they're being tricked into writing 40-plus essays, and it doesn't feel like schoolwork. And it's just the way I roll. You two in this Comp 1 are going to keep an academic journal like all my students ever have, and I'm going to give you the option. You can do it a couple ways. It's fine if you want to type it. There'll be a folder at the end of the week. We'll leave it open till, Saturday night. And you can do one of two things. You can give me the handwritten prose, okay, typed entries. I'll create one folder. You're only going to be able to make one entry because I got to minimize the clicks, man, in online teaching. So you're not going to be giving me 2, 3, 4 different files. I'm going to constrain you to one file submission. I hope you don't find that tyrannical. And you can put in typed prose. And if you want, you can also keep a notebook with a pen and take photographs of your notebook. That makes it a little harder for me because it's kind of harder to read, but I don't care about that. Don't worry about that. This isn't entirely about my comfort level, although my happiness looms above yours. I've got to be happy, most of all. I'm being satirical again. Satire is like crystal meth to me. Have I mentioned that yet? And I may type out responses. I got a little tennis elbow going. We'll see how it goes. Or I might leave a quick audio response. I love using those wave recordings. I love typing. I'm super good at it. But I do generally respond to student writing with wave files. So you'll get little recordings of me all semester saying, "Hey, thanks for this." And then I pick out a thing or two to let you know that I really, really read what you wrote, the way you wrote it, one word at a time. If you ever turn and ask me a question in the journal, I will answer it. But I want to get to know you as a human being and have some kind of teacher-student relationship with you. And that's not easy, doing this online. There's some remarks about the Academic Journal in the syllabus, I'm pretty sure. But it works. It works. It helps people become better writers. You've got to write to learn how to write. In the same way that you got to learn how to drive a car by driving a car. Nobody learns how to drive by taking lots of car rides. And I'm hoping I'm making sense to you right now. Now for my last thing today at the 15 minute mark, I'm probably going to go a little past 20 today, so watch out. I've been reading a book written by a friend of mine, Professor Deborah Appleman, who's a professor at the most elite college in this state, which is Carleton, down in Northfield, Minnesota. I've known her now for about almost 15 years, and I won't go into my friendship with her and what we've helped each other understand as friends and fellow English teachers in the great state of Minnesota. She's teaching into her 70s, looks like to me, and she's my hero. I'm hoping to do the same. She wrote a book called Literature and the New Culture Wars. And basically what it is an acknowledgement that teaching English right now is suddenly a very dangerous occupation because there's tremendous pressures in the classroom regarding literature. And this book came out of basically a moment where she freaked out and realized, wait a minute, I've been teaching English for years, things are changing fast. All these years, she thought it was kind of the far right that was coming after English classes and saying, censor this book, cancel this book, get rid of this teacher. What's astonishing to her right now and provoked her to write the book, nudged her to write the book, she's realizing that similar great forces are coming from the left with their own demands on college English teachers and teachers in general. Now, this is kind of, incendiary stuff to think about, but I've been watching it all my life. Maybe my 36 years of English teaching is actually a history of me offending people, because sometimes it happens. Sometimes it happens accidentally. You might give a student a poem or a story or a work of dramatic work, and it might provoke a certain response. Maybe it makes them nervous. Maybe it makes them upset. And with caution, I'm going to put up in D2L two things for you to think about. And this is the first thing I'm going to ask you to read this semester, except for the syllabus. And optionally, I'm going to give you another way to think about this. And let's start with thing number one. We've got to be careful here. We've got to be courteous. We've got to be respectful. And one of the things that you're not going to find me being is political, which is pretty rare for teachers. Generally, college professors are very left-leaning Democrats. I'm nothing. I've never been a member of a political party. I think politics is loathsome, unbecoming, and a waste of time. If that offended you, well then, you're offended. Forgive me. I look to poets for the answers because they have never let me down. And that's me. That's me. I'm not a member of a political party. I sometimes don't even vote. But I do adore my life as a teacher, and I'm feeling the same headwinds that Carolyn Forché. Couple of examples. I want to put before you an essay that I had to cut and paste out of the New York Times. We got trouble going at Hamline University, and actually it's at every school in the country, and it's relatively new. Remember, I've got a long view, 36 years, I'm finishing my fourth decade. This is new. Things are changing fast, too fast, and things are also breaking down. And it's scaring me, because if you want to be in a civilization, you need civilized people. And we seem to have fewer of them every minute. At Hamline University last fall, example number one, an art teacher knew that she was going to teach an art class, and she she also knew what kind of art she was going to be putting before the students for their consideration. She told them in the syllabus, okay, this is an art class. You can expect and anticipate Christian imagery, as well as imagery from other great world religions. I might show you an image of the Buddha. I might show you an image of Christ. I might show you I am going to show you an image of Muhammad. Well, she kind of must have known she was headed for trouble right there, because even though it's not in the Quran, many Muslims, many, not all, but many Muslims have the idea that they should never, ever be shown an image of Muhammad, because they're nervous that they could start to worship the image instead of Allah. And again, regarding other great world religions, for me the three greatest are Islam, Judaism, and Christianity. Freudian slip. And she let them know. And then when it came time for the day that she was going to show this image in St. Paul, Minnesota at Hamlin, she gave everybody in the room a trigger warning. A trigger warning, you might know what that is. It's when a teacher gives you a heads up and says, hey, you know, I'm about to show something that might be hard for you. And if that's so, you can leave the room. Kind of like when an eighth grade girl historically says to another eighth grade girl, no offense, but I don't really like your hair today. Well, that's an eighth grade girl telling another eighth grade girl, I'm preemptively about to offend you. So you better get ready. And because I'm telling you, you're not going to be able to confute or rebut what I just am about to say. The moment came, she put up not a satirical mocking image of Muhammad, but a very important historical medieval painting of Muhammad. And there was a Sudanese student in that room, and she didn't say a word about it. She had an opportunity to leave the room. She didn't, and she got upset. She approached the teacher after class, went to administration, and that professor was fired before the week was over. The professor was an adjunct. And adjuncts can be gotten rid of just like that. They can just be brushed aside. Unlike tenured people like me. I'm going to invite you to read that and think about it. And I'm putting more questions before you than there are answers, although I do have an answer that I'll better write down so I don't forget to talk about it. Second, I'm like, what? This has got to be under 25 minutes. Second example, a little more dramatic, and it's totally optional. I'm not giving you a trigger warning, but I want to tell you that the 7-minute miniature documentary that I want to spin and put up in D2L is about something that happened in 2017 at Evergreen State College out in, I think, Washington State. Very liberal, very progressive since the 60s, very strong left-leaning school, had a serious disaster happen. A bunch of students got together and they decided, okay, in order to fight racism, discrimination, and to create a balance of equity, we're going to have a day, and this happens everywhere, we're going to have a day on campus where no white people of any authority, specifically faculty and administrators, support staff, you can't come to campus. Take a day off. And what happened pretty quickly is that a biology professor, they're named Brad, I think, he didn't like that idea. Even though he's way left, way progressive, and on the sides of the students, he sent an email to every other teacher on campus and said, you know what? This is a bad idea. And it's ill-conceived, and I'm not going to participate. I'm going to deliver my biology lecture that day. The students, as you'll see, went out of their minds and more or less formed what William Faulkner would recognize as a mob. People have a right to academic freedom. People also have a right to, within limits, to not be uncomfortable, but sometimes an education is painful, or moments of an education can be challenging, especially when you're encountering ideas or people that are antithetical to you. I'm going to take 30 seconds to say this, and I'm going to say it. It's just what I wrote to my students, my live students. The antidote to this in any classroom is love. We have got to love one another. And that is one of the three requirements of my course. Love, patience, and wonder. But love is the most important of all. Love informs all teaching, all learning. Love informs all human activities that are worth doing, okay? And the rules of my classroom, and it pretty does a good job at helping me hold sway. We are going to encounter differences with each other's thinking. But if we are courteous and respectful and most of all love each other through the differences, what you'll possibly peek in on and look at it in the 2017 thing at Evergreen State, it won't happen to us. It won't happen anywhere. The thing about that video, I'm making it optional because there's serious F-bombs in it on the part of the students. That might make you happy. I personally am in flight from profanity and Hollywood. I hate Hollywood. I'll leave that exhortation for another day. Let's cut this right now. This is video 2 of the week. You'll see one more from me later in the week. You're going to have a journal entry. This will be two journal entries, actually. And I'll put that in D2L and I'll create a Dropbox for it. Give me your handwritten prose, or if you want, your typed off prose. I'm happy with either, reading either. It's faster reading typed prose, believe me. I can take it in at a glance. But you'll make that decision. I hope to hear from your vote on the discussion forum by the end of this day. I probably better make some kind of decision on that soon because syllabi legally have to be out by Friday. I love you guys, even though I hardly know you. And I will see you very soon.